I should have Coney Island there, driving around.
I mean, I should have that.
Tell me I can't.
Welcome to the John D. Calandro Italian American Institute. I'm Rosangela Briscesa. I'm the Assistant Director for Academic and Cultural Programs here. I think we are all very excited tonight to be presenting Italo-Americana, the Literature of the Great Migration, 1880 to 1943. And it was just published from Fordham University Press. And we have with us this evening the editor of the American publication, Robert Viscusi, the translation editor, Anthony Tamburi, the bibliography editor, James Periconi, and the editor of the original Italian edition, Francesco Durante. And the book is for sale. We have the paperback. It's normally $40, but we have it for $30. So I think that you can't afford not to buy this book. So you should come up after the event, and you can even get it signed. I'm sure that our editors will be happy to do that for you. Before I introduce the dean, I just want to remind you that there's a sign-up sheet in the back of the room in case you're not on our mailing list. You can sign up for it. There's also the brochure for our semester's events, although that's winding down. You'll hear a little bit about our remaining events in a moment. But if you're on our mailing list, then you can be sure that you'll find out about any events that we add to our schedule. And I'm sure that we will have more events to tell you about. Finally, I want to remind you to please make sure that your phones are silenced. And with that, I will introduce the Dean of the Institute, Anthony Tamburi.
First, I want to make a few comments before I ask the director of Fordham University Press to come up as well. But I want to do a little bit of housekeeping. First of all, we have two more events left for our regular programming. May 13th, Tuesday, this is something we've added. Chiara Martini from the University of Foreigners of Perugia will be sharing with us some of her research on translating Flannery O'Connor into Italian. And it proves to be a really exciting topic and an exciting lecture because there are really some funny and challenging and funny results from trying to translate sort of, whether we want to call it dialect, patois, whatever, from English into Italian. It doesn't always work. So it'll be fun. And then, of course, the 15th, we have our last MOVE documentary for the season, and that is Men of Cloth. No, it's not about the church. It is about Taylor. So, and that'll be the 15th. So, and then the other thing I want to, although, actually, Fred, you can invite everybody tomorrow. So this is really an extremely important publication, and just to contextualize it a little bit, it is about, as you'll hear us talk later, but it is about introducing to the American public writings that had originally been done in Italian here in the United States. And that's what this 2014 edition is. But the 2005 edition, which is also here, not for sale, it's somebody's private copy, hint, hint, that was a historical moment in Italy, because for the first time, the Italians can get an overview of writing in Italian that took place outside of Italy, specifically in the United States. 80% of those 900 and some odd pages in the Italo-Americana was originally written in Italian, and very few, he's rightfully so, as far as a thought process he was concerned, he included also some writers in English, and he closes with Pietro di Donato, if I'm not mistaken. I haven't looked at the index recently, but he's towards the end, Pietro di Donato, which of course had to be included regardless of his language, right? So, but also we need to compliment Fordham University Press. We need to compliment Francesco for the intellectual, editorial, and as they say in Spanish, raton de biblioteca work that he engaged in to put all this together, but also Fordham University Press for taking on the challenge of putting together such a book. Also because Fordham University Press has joined a very few smaller number of other academic presses in having a regular series in Italian-American studies. And as for specifically just Italian-American, there are only two, but then there are two other series that deal also with Italian and Italian-American studies. So, So without further ado, I'll ask Fred Nachbauer to come up and say a few words.
Wow, I must say this has been quite the exciting week of celebrating the publication of Italo-Americana, the Literature of the Great Migration, 1880 to 1943, edited by Francesco Durante. As Anthony said, my name is Fred Nachbauer, and I'm the director of Fordham University Press, publisher of the English language edition. It is overwhelming to see this book come to light after a long journey that started before I came to Fordham in 2009, so it predates me. There are countless people that have made contributions for whom I'm so grateful. There are translators, a few of whom are here today, I think. Thank you for your commitment and hard work in making this book accessible to English language readers. The generations of people who will benefit from this important collection is monumental. The donors, including Margo and Anthony Viscusi, who threw a wonderful reception this past Sunday, and Laura Sillerman, who hosted a festive and fun dinner on Tuesday that was full of great chatter, laughter, food, and even singing by Francesco Durante himself. It was wonderful. They have made it possible for us to produce a beautiful book and to launch it to an American audience. Thanks to you and to all the donors who saw the importance and value in publishing this book. I'm honored to have Fordham University Press as the publisher. It ties into our commitment to publishing critical works in Italian-American studies. Soon after starting at Fordham University Press, I established the Critical Studies in Italian America, co-edited by Nancy Carnevale and Lenata Roberto. Italo-Americana predated the series, so we decided to keep it as a standalone book that complements the series and reinforces Fordham's commitment to publishing books focused on Italian-American studies. And Fordham University has a long history serving the Italian-American community. Its Rose Hill campus is steps from Arthur Avenue, Bronx's Little Italy, and a huge population of Italian-Americans has graduated from its colleges. The law school, even, was established primarily to serve immigrant students, including Italians that were shunned from Columbia and NYU. It still remains the one law school in New York City that has a night program catering to working students. Geraldine Ferraro is a graduate whose family recently made a significant contribution to the law school. I say all of this to show that Italo-Americana has found a good home with Fordham. Even though I myself am not an Italian-American, I feel like an honorary member of the community by working on this book. This book would not have been made possible without the tireless efforts and dedication of the editors of the American edition, Bob Viscusi, Anthony Tambori, and James Ferraconi. Thank you so much to you and the Calandra Institute for your Herculean work on Italo-Americana and being champions of Italian-American studies. I want to thank everyone on my staff for all their efforts in editing, designing, and marketing the book. And I also want to thank Jennifer Romanello, the outside publicist, for the book, for her savvy in reaching the media, some of whom were in attendance at Laura's dinner on Tuesday. Sam Roberts of the New York Times took a copy home that night, despite the book's heft and my willingness to mail him a copy later on. So that was quite impressive. Finally, I want to thank Francesco Durante for being the genius behind the collection and having the wisdom and foresight to bring the writing together so that the stories, the people, the history, the culture of these Italian Americans don't get lost or buried in archives. The book will keep them alive long into the future. Thank you.
Robert Viscusi is professor of English and executive officer of the Wolf Institute for the Humanities at Brooklyn College. The author of 8 books and many scholarly articles, Viscusi has won an American Book Award for his novel Astoria, the Premio Giuseppe Acerbi for his book Buried Caesars and Other Secrets of Italian-American Writing, and the Brooklyn College Faculty Creative Writing Award for his poem Ellis Island, and he's the editor of the American edition of Italo-Americana. Anthony Julian Tamburi is dean of the John D. Calandra Italian-American Institute, where he is the executive producer of the TV program Italics. He's also the former president of the Italian-American Studies Association and the American Association of Teachers of Italian. His latest book is Rereading Italian-Americana, published by Fairleigh Dickinson University Press in 2013, and he is the translation editor of Italo-Americana. James J. Ferraconi, a Manhattan attorney, exhibited his collection of more than 100 Italian language American imprints of authors whose works are excerpted in Italo-Americana at New York's Grolier Club in 2012 and extensively cataloged these works in the book Strangers in a Strange Land, and he's the bibliography editor of the book. And Francesco Durante is a journalist as well as professor of literature at the University of Suor Orsola Benincasa as part of the program in Modern Languages and Culture, and he's the editor of the original Italian edition of Italo Americana. So please welcome our four editors.
I think the best way to start would be to ask Francesco to begin about why he thought this was important and just some of the challenges.
You mean the American edition?
Or the
book itself?
The book itself, yeah. The book itself.
Well, I thought it was important to find out this underground material, just like doing a work of archaeology in some 70s libraries and archives on both sides of the ocean, because when the book was published in Italy, Italy had just become a country of immigration after having been for a long time a country of emigration. And I felt that we had forgotten what we used to be at the end of the 20th century. So with taking back the memories of that incredible season of emigration, Italian emigration in the world, 6 million Italians from 1880 to 1915, which was 1/6 of the entire population of the country, getting back this memory was important in order to become a country that can be able to accept new people coming from other countries, you know. And besides, we had quite forgotten our past, and sometimes we felt even ashamed of our past of emigration. And I think that we should be very proud of our past of emigration, because this contributed to the building of such big countries as America. And the performance of Italian Americans in America is something astonishing, considering from which point they started. They were the poorest part of the population in Italy. They had no hope in the future of a country which was a feudal country. If you were born a peasant, you would die a peasant. And going to America, they entered history for the first time. And for the first time, they could tell their own story without any mediation. There was not an aristocratic writer to tell what they did. They were themselves telling their story. Mm-hmm. And this is precisely what you can find in this book, along with some incredible gems, as Bernardino Ciambelli, whom I call the Homer of Mulberry Street. You know, nobody in Italy knew that in 1893 there was a Tuscan guy in New York publishing novels in Italian describing New York, describing the Italian neighborhood in New York and their relation with the Jews, with the Chinese, with all the great works that were going taking place in New York, the underground, the elevated, and so on, the modernity, the spirit of this modernity. Mm-hmm. And he told this in a very popular but very, how can I say, gripping way. It's a turn page. In the manner of Eugène Sue, Le Mystère de Paris, or Francesco Mastriani, Misteri di Napoli, those are the models. And Bernardino Ciambelli is possibly one of the most energetic authors in telling the history of how New York became cosmopolis, you know? And nobody knew him in Italy, because one thing that I can tell about this book, Jim Pericone knows these things very well. For instance, the second novel by Bernardino Ciambelli, I Sotterranei di New York, there are two only copies existing in the world. One is, I can't remember in this moment, in New York or in the Library of the Congress in Washington. And the second one is in a small city in Campania, Avellino, in the Biblioteca Provinciale of Avellino. But there is, in this book, you can find even rarer, more rare books. For instance, Camillo Cianfarra, Il Diario di un Emigrato. There is only one copy in the world, and it is in Minneapolis, at the Immigration History Research Center. So, you know, collecting all this material was something that resembled an adventure, a safari, something in an unknown land, and it was exciting.
I have a copy of that.
No, excuse me, I told I Sotterranei di New York, I had to say I Drammi delle Migrazioni,
and
you don't have a copy.
I have I Sotterranei di New York.
No, you're right. I made a gap. But there is a lot of books quite impossible to find, you know, and of course in Italian libraries quite nothing is kept. Maybe, but we are organizing ourselves, Jim Periconi and Bob Discusi, we are doing an expedition in southern Italy.
Absolutely.
In order to explore any attic and any cellar in southern Italy before all these papers will be thrown away, you know. So maybe we find something else.
Absolutely.
Let's stay a little bit within theme first, and then we'll come back around again about the difficulties of, or the challenges of putting the book together. Why don't you talk a little bit about the challenges of putting the American edition together, and then you can talk also specifically about the bibliography.
Okay.
And what that entailed.
The challenges of doing this were many. When I saw the book in 2005, is when it came out, I said, actually even the first volume of it, which is about the earlier part from 1776 to 1879, I guess, I thought, this will, I actually wrote a blurb for it. I said, this will be an atomic bomb in Italian-American studies. And the reason that I thought this is that I had been doing lots of work on Italian-American writing for a long time, but mostly from, let's say, the 1920s on, and mostly people who wrote only in English. And somewhere along the way, I learned Italian. I went and lived in Rome for a year, and I learned Italian serviceably well. I mean, I can read the books. But when I wanted to venture further back, I was really at a loss because, you know, I was trained in English and American literature. Now, if you are trained in English literature and you decide that you want to write about even a fairly obscure writer, I wrote my doctorate dissertation on Max Beerbohm, not a very widely read writer, but there are dozens of things. There are biographies and bibliographies and major collections and letters and just all kinds of stuff and people that you can interview. And it took me 6 or 7 years to actually write that book because there was so much material. When I wanted to write about Carlo Barsotti, I couldn't find much, almost nothing. When I wanted to investigate the writers that I read in the Progresso in the 1890s, I mean, that were in the Progresso of the year. I wasn't reading them in the 1890s. I wish I had been, but no. I couldn't find anything about them. And what I could find often confused me more than it helped me, because I really didn't understand the context. And the thing that I most realized that I didn't understand was the connection between this little colonial universe that they were building in New York and San Francisco and Boston and a few other big cities, the connection between that and the Italy that was contemporaneous with it. I just didn't know enough. I mean, I read plenty of Italian history, but it was at a level of grandeur that didn't really touch this kind of stuff. The Italians weren't interested in it. I'm not sure what they're interested in, actually. It's hard to find sometimes. And not only were there all of these writers in it, but there was also a vast wealth of commentary. General commentary about the different kinds of writing. There are several kinds of writing in this book. Dramatic writing, poetic writing, fiction, journalism.
Politics.
Politics, enormous amount of politics. And politics, like, you know, politics like they used to be around the table in Astoria when I was a kid. You know, I had one grandfather who was a fascist and another grandfather who was a communist. And I don't think that was so unusual. And, you know, they weren't polite. They didn't actually throw things. You know, they didn't throw things, but they screamed and yelled and they drank a lot of wine. Really a lot of wine, and the more wine they drank, of course, the louder they got, and it was very exciting. And then a couple of years later, everybody became a Republican, and it was like they had died. I mean, it was, I don't mean anything bad about the Republicans, at this moment, anyway. It was very sad. So I couldn't really understand a lot of what I was reading, even though I could read it, I mean, I could decode it, I could translate it, sort of, but I couldn't really understand it. I didn't know how it fit with everything else that was going on around it. And, you know, I'm a voracious reader. I mean, I really read a lot, but it didn't quite make it. And then I read this. And here, now, there's something else that I have to add about this. It's not only that Francesco has first-rate literary education in Italy. He studied with, among other people, Vittore Branca, one of the great philologists of the 20th century. He is a terrifically fluent writer. But the thing that really made the biggest difference to me, and you've already seen an example of it when he was talking about Bernardino Ciambelli, was his absolutely unmitigated enthusiasm for these writers. Because when I read them sort of the way my father kind of taught me to regard these things. My father was a typical second-generation Italian-American. He was embarrassed by all of this stuff. You know, he would go out every morning and get his father the Progresso. And his father also took the Folia, which came every week or so. But he wasn't interested. My father wasn't interested. He said, that's all old stuff. You know, America, that's it. We have to build rocket ships. And while I violently disagreed with him, you know how these things are, I actually took all of this in, and I thought, oh, these people are of no account. And it was hard for me to take them seriously, the way you would take a writer seriously. You know, if I read Henry James, I was like, oh, Henry James. But the idea of reading Bernardino Ciambelli as if he were a great writer was something I couldn't have even imagined doing. And here I met Francesco Durante, and also his close colleague Martino Marazzi, who talk about these things like they're thrilled when they find a poem by Fanny Lucini in San Francisco, or they found the original of a novel that we thought was first published in the first Italian American novel. Probably it was published in French. We thought
when I got the picture of Bernardino Ciambelli.
Yes.
In the prison.
Right, in the prison of Colorado,
Colorado,
right?
Yes.
With the number. yeah, I mean, we didn't know much. But that volume was found by Martino Marazzi in the San Francisco Public Library. What? You know, I mean, so it started to penetrate to me that this was something like really the most exciting moment in Italian literary history, which is the 15th century, when Petrarca and Niccolò Niccoli and Poggio Bracciolini and these guys got the idea of going around to all the monasteries in northern Italy and Switzerland and looking at the bottoms of barrels for lost works by Cicero and Quintilian, and then they found them too. You know, they found many of the most important works of classical antiquity, textbooks that were used for centuries that had been buried thanks to the rise of fanaticism in the Catholic Church in the 4th century. Of course, it has subsided last year. you know, it was an enormous event, and it really fathered what we call modern literature. or what they used to call the Renaissance. It's very, very, very important. I felt that this was equally very important. And so we looked at how to make it happen, and it wasn't so easy, because we needed a lot of translators. I'll let Anthony talk about the translators, because that's what he did. But finding them took a lot of work, but we also had to find supporters. It was going to cost a lot of money to do this. And so I spoke to some people that I knew. The first person I spoke to was Jim, and we set up an event at the Guerrilla Club back in, when was it, 2006 or 2007.
Yeah.
And we invite, what?
Francesco
came and talked about it, and one of the people who was there was Anthony Viscusi, and he was converted, and then he talked to some other people, and soon we had a number of people who were capable of helping us and willing to help us. The Viscusis, Laura Sillerman, who was enormously generous and helpful, and a lot of other people. Some of them are also in this room. I don't have the list in front of me. I don't want to start naming people because I'm not sure if I leave anybody out. And then we had to do it. And it was really hard. It was really, really hard because these people write in all kinds of different languages. You know, Italian is an umbrella term. It means almost everything. I mean, there's Italian that you learn in Perugia, and then there's Neapolitan, and then there's Sicilian, and then there are 45 varieties of Neapolitan, actually. They're not all the same. And there's 145 varieties of Sicilian, and there's Ladin, and there's just no end of possibilities. And finding people to translate all of this well was very difficult. Organizing it was very difficult. I had no experience doing that. Fortunately, eventually, I got an assistant who was a genius at organizing these things, and then it started to go a little better. But it took us quite a while, and everything needed to be. Anthony and I read every translation how many times?
We did.
Again and again and again and again and again and again. And I mean, it was a few years at least that we were doing that. And then after we finished, we started proofreading the whole book, which again we did. I really can't remember how many times, and yet I keep finding mistakes in it. They're not important. and Fordham has already told us that if we keep a list of, there were tiny little things, you know, an eye that survived where it shouldn't be, something like that, that they'll remove them in the next printing. Hope that happens. So it took a long time, and it was quite an education in every dimension that there is. I mean, I learned the thing that I had set out to learn, which wasn't really so much the knowledge of the relationship between these people and Italy, but it was the knowledge of the relationship between these people and the Italian inside, I guess, just about every one of us, starting with myself. In other words, I stopped feeling ashamed of them. I stopped feeling ridiculously critical of them. I started looking at them from the inside. This is something that I owe, and everybody who reads this book will owe, to Professor Durante, because he showed us this. He showed us how this could be. I don't think an Italian-American scholar could have done it. I think that we were all infected with this same kind of, you know, vergogna. I don't know exactly what it is. Prezzolini used to call it touchiness, you know, Italiani. So either Americani or per malos. Why? It's a good question, but we still are kind of touchy. And so to find an Italian, a genuinely super duper qualified Italian, such as Francesco, who loved this stuff and could show what was terrific about it, was a major transformation, I think, personally for us, for Jim, for me, for the few other people who worked on it, Anthony, but will be a major transformation for everybody that reads this book.
Thank you. Why don't you tell us a bit about the bibliography,
sure.
and you could even insert a little bit about your own,
sure.
You know, because it's tied into it.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Anthony. I guess there's two things I wanted to talk about. One is the, but I won't dwell too long because it's really very few people who are really that excited about the making of a bibliography. But so I'll be brief on it. I'll just say there's no greater pleasure for a bibliographer than finding mistakes in his predecessors. But I'll be damned if I could find mistakes this guy made. The worst mistake he made was citing 1914 as the year of Caruso's Caricature, when in fact the first edition was 1908. That's as bad as it got. That wasn't very bad, really, but that was as bad as it got. But seriously, I did a little supplementation of Francesco's really flawless bibliography, and it just reflected, as the man himself had predicted, when he originally, and if I may just take a moment to read a couple of sentences of his prediction in, I think it was in volume two, maybe it was in volume one, he predicted, he said, Francesco wrote in 2005, that was the introduction to this volume. I am perfectly aware that this anthology is provisional, a sort of permanent workshop, constantly open to new research and further discoveries. The book looks forward to other scholarly research that will go even deeper into the libraries and archives that I have visited. And why not? Perhaps a new author or title will be miraculously discovered. There are still thousands of attics to pick through, and perhaps in a few of them a surviving copy of some lost novel by Bernardino Ciambelli, or the typescript of some play by Riccardo Codiferro, or an unfindable volume of some lost Italian-American newspaper awaits us in silence. And indeed, that's what happened. And of course, I had the benefit that he didn't have earlier in the decade and in the late 90s of many online resources that, but of course I had to start with what he had done, and online resources looking at some of the same authors and then following certain words and phrases and finding other things. And then I'm a collector, so you know, I collected these books, and as has been mentioned, I had a show at the Grolier Club in the year 2012, which was really a startling and wonderful experience, because there were a couple of skeptics at the club who thought, you know, who think that books that don't have gorgeous binding and extraordinary paper can't be all that interesting. In fact, when they saw the materials, I guess we can't pull aside the, can we pull this back a little bit, or will that make a mess?
It'll make a mess.
Anyway, there's a, maybe I can just pull the poster down. Do you mind?
No.
It'll just take a moment. But these are some of the books that I had in the show, and many of you have seen this poster, but they're really, you know, extraordinarily beautiful and varied, and they, you know, reflect what the books are about. So I think it was a very pleasant experience, for people to see. The second thing that I want to talk about really relates to what I just said, and that is, what does it mean to put together? As Bob talked earlier, we haven't had the bibliographic apparatus in Italian-American studies, really. There's some wonderful early work by Cordasco, especially, very excellent early work, but nothing really comprehensive, and Cordasco concentrated in a few areas. And Francesco's contribution, of course, the major contribution is the writings, but his bibliography is the beginnings, or the beginnings of the sort of second wave of creating a serious bibliographic apparatus. And the most touching thing that happened to me from doing the show at the Grolier Club, and there were many such touching things, including lots of praise by Italian-Americanists, but I kind of expected that, and I'm glad it happened, but I had expected it. But what was really extraordinary was seeing people in the larger world of bibliography and book history pay attention, take notice, show respect for what we were doing. One of the high points after the show was visiting the booth of probably one of the most important, sophisticated, prestigious dealers in Americana. His name is William Reese, William Reese and Company in New Haven. And I visited the booth at the American Antiquarian Book Fair, and I won't tell the whole story, but one clerk figured out who I was. He referred to me, not knowing who I was, as that famous person had bought a certain book that they had sold it. And I said, well, why am I famous? And he said, well, Mr. Reese bought two copies of your catalog. He had us all read them. He says, this fills an important gap in American publishing history. And I don't say it to pat myself on the back, because, again, my work really began with Francesco's work at the core. And our good friend Anthony Viscusi, who's in the second row there, has often said that this story that we're telling with this book and the story that Italian Americanists are generally telling isn't just some narrow story of one ethnic group in a little dustbin corner of history, but this is part of the American story. And so taking that to the next step, this work is a larger version of what I had done in my small way, but this work is creating a new chapter in, or uncovering, let us say, an older chapter in American book publishing history. And so it begins to become an integral part of what our culture is about as Americans. And ultimately, that's very, very satisfying. So that was the pleasure of working on the book, and that's what we came up with.
Great. Thank you. I want to talk just briefly about the translations, and I also want to briefly contextualize this in a specific way. When we had a conversation, a long conversation, about the translators, whom we should invite, why, etc. Of course, obviously, first and foremost, because they were good translators, because they gave a really nice rendition in English. But there was an attempt to include, as far as the non-introductory material, because there are four basic introductions. Those were not done by what I'm going to say. We decided that the translators of everything in this book, except for the introductions, would be people of Italian origin. We just wanted to do that. And we were able to satisfy that sort of desire we had with the quality of people translating. And then we had a couple of consiglieri along the way, and they also helped us along. It was nice to be able to have someone who perhaps didn't do the translation but could give an expert second opinion on certain things, and we think that really rounded out, smoothed out some things that we thought were a little rough. It was we were fortunate. I don't think anyone said no. I think everyone said yes. We also tried to those who know some of the translators will notice that there are also one or two ideological affinities. That is, the translator might be ideologically keen to the person or to the text that they translated. That was another sort of decision we took in mind. So we would, if we knew good poets in English who were bilingual, and we thought they would be good for the poetry, obviously, and so on and so forth. So everything sort of seemed to work out. And people, for the most part, got the stuff in on time, and so I think in that sense it wasn't that major of a deal. My thought at the beginning was that it was going to be like herding cats. We're not going to be able to get people to give us stuff on time, et cetera, et cetera. Especially considering you can see the heft of the book. The manuscript was about this high when we finally had a complete manuscript, and that was actually the proofs, one single-sided proof. So, but I want to talk about this other aspect of it. This book, this Italian version, first and foremost, really, and this is the flip side of what Bob was saying, really put Italians on notice, first and foremost. Mm-hmm. Italians in general, but professors of Italian literature and culture. It put them on notice. They could no longer giggle, and they could no longer laugh about Italian Americans. Mm-hmm. Bob mentions Prezzolini. What he didn't mention was that Prezzolini, when he finally took all of his writings that he did over the years and put them together, what he did was he talked about the Italian immigrant as someone, and these are his words, turbato di mente. Those are the words that he uses, and he actually put it in italics. I think he didn't want to be as harsh as that might sound out of context, but still, the fact that he used such a term, And then, of course, when you go to read the chapter in America Primo Amore by Mario Soldati, and the way he talks about the Italo-Americani and how he made this long trip into the hinterlands of the Bronx, and so on and so forth. And so you see how there was a great lack of sympathy, let alone empathy, sympathy for the Americans of that generation. And that continued, and it continued into my experience when, while I was and continue to be an Italianist, would be in Italy, and I would occasionally mention about Italian Americans, I would get chuckles, and I would get chuckles from Americanists, both in literary and historical studies. And they would chuckle, and oh yeah, those Italians down, oh yeah, I saw them down in Mulberry Street, and oh yeah, I've been to Little Italy, and so on and so forth. So when this book comes, so in 1994, when the region of Florence decides to do a two-day symposium on razzismo in Italy, and they use that term, razzismo, which is a rare use of the word, really, in Italian, meaning it the way we mean racism in English. When they used it in reference to those whom they used to call the vous comprat, and there was nothing wrong among Italians to use that term back then, fortunately it's no longer used. When they used those terms to refer to the Africans, the Senegalese especially, they couldn't understand that that was an analogous phenomenon to what had happened 100 years before. They couldn't understand that what they were now experiencing was no more than an analogous repetition of history, of their emigration history, as opposed to what was now beginning to develop, which is now, as Francesco said, their immigration history. So that prefix, M and Im, those prefixes, are extremely important. So it put the Italians on notice. And it also put the Italians on notice, as I said, in literary studies. And so that they could no longer make the comments as well. Occasionally, some of us who are Italianists would find ourselves in groups. We would be the only, quote unquote, foreigner. And we would have to remind them, I'm an Italian-American too. And you know, they say, yes, but you're different. And this is my experience from 1971 to today. I still experience the once in a while, yes, you're different. Yes, but you're different. And we know, we've heard that in this country with regard to African Americans. Yeah, but he's different. Yeah, but she's different, right? So it did that. Now, what this book also does in English is put the American literary establishment on notice. And not the American the American establishment that considers itself to be part of the literati, that group. It puts that group on notice. So that group now has to sort of deal with, in some ways, with writers now who were here at the end of the 19th century. That it's no longer just Vittorini and Svevo and Calvino and whoever else, Pirandello, and Moravia, and whoever else was writing in the 20th century. But now there are those who preceded all of these people, some of whom, by the way, perhaps we might say less in Italian language, but surely in English, such as a Mangione and a Fante, who actually influenced the young writers of the 30s and 40s, of the 40s in Italy, the so-called leftists of Vittorini, Pavese, and so on and so forth. So that's what this book does in the much larger sense, for me, coming from an Italianist perspective.
I don't even know where to start. You touched so many buttons. And, my favorite event of this kind happened in Madison, Wisconsin. It's a very beautiful campus. Outside of Berkeley, maybe the most pleasant campus in the whole country, especially because it doesn't feel like a medieval church, which I had enough of when I was young. It was a conference of the AAIS, and I was on a panel with a couple of people, including a very, very distinguished Italianist, who I I won't name because it wouldn't be kind, who, after I spoke, I was advancing, I had been doing this for a long time already, I was advancing the idea to Italianists who were always complaining that they didn't have enough students, and that there was a lot of complaining goes on among Italians, at least it did in those days. I'd say, you know, there's a huge potential student body of Italian Americans that might be interested in taking your courses if you would teach them in such a way that they thought they belonged there. You know, there's a lot of Italian American writers that are very good. You could do this. And, you know, there are people who listen to it, actually, and there are a lot more Italianists who are teaching Italian American writing, even in English, than there were then. But this gentleman said to me, you don't belong here. You shouldn't even be here. And, you know, I was in front of a big room full of colleagues like that. I didn't know how to reply to that. I couldn't possibly equal it for rudeness because I respected him. I had read his books. I liked him. And I was deeply hurt. Another time, another fellow whom I didn't have such a good opinion of, at another one of these conferences, said, you know, this isn't literature. This is sociology. Now, I don't know what's wrong with sociology, actually. but he seemed to say that this isn't literature, this is fish wrappings. That's what he seemed to be meaning. And he afterward changed his tune, and he wrote a book about the very writer that I was talking about. So, you know, we've had that pleasure. Anthony and I have been laboring in this vineyard for a long time. And we've had the pleasure of actually seeing some people turn around. But I will say, you know, I don't have quite the anger at the Americanists that I used to have and that I think Anthony was giving voice to, although I certainly share it. But it's not as strong with me because I've had occasion to reflect. When I first came into Italian-American studies in 1979, I went to a meeting at the Istituto Italiano di Cultura on Park Avenue, where Jerry Mangione was talking about this huge grant that he had gotten to write a book that was going to be for Italian Americans what Irving Howe's The World of the Fathers was for Jewish Americans. It had come out not long before that, and it's a great book, and it's a very important book about the, you know, early history of Jewish American writing, especially the press. And the whole intellectual ferment around it, and political ferment. And so, they worked on it for years and years and years and years. Jerry Mangione, he had a team of people, he had a huge grant, he spent all the money. Eventually he had a co-author. And when the book came out, it was such a vast disappointment. There were, in the 70s, there were about four passable histories of Italian Americans. This book didn't have anything in it that they didn't have, except that many of the words were not spelled correctly, which was not necessarily an improvement.
And the bibliography was a complete mess.
Well, the bibliography, yeah.
Complete mess. Lines transposed, wrong years,
and,
wrong publishers. Yeah.
And so that has always, in my mind, been a vast wound, self-inflicted by Italian Americans, to our literary fortunes. You know, literature is as conservative as the Catholic Church. You know, the Catholic Church, when they initiate you into the Catholic Church, when the bishop confirms you, that's when you really become a Catholic. And they tell you that he's a bishop because someone laid hands on him who had hands laid on him, who had laid hands laid all the way back to St. Peter. Now, is this true? Well, if you think it's true, that's good enough. And we did. And literature is like that. It has a lot to do with cultural seniority. It has a lot to do with having a collective memory. I mean, any literature worth the name. And this book restores to, and the book that precedes it, which we're going to figure out how to get into English too, but this book.
You said something very risky. I take for sure. Okay.
Okay. Fine. He believes everything I say, which is helpful. This book restores to us our literary memory. And when I say restores to us our literary, I didn't know who most of these writers were. And I've been reading this stuff for a long, long time. The later ones, you know, Carnevale, Eduardo Corsi, people like that, yes. But Ciambelli, my. Dario Papa, who isn't actually in the book, but he's quoted, and he, and of all of the early journalists, is my favorite, bar none. Wonderful, wonderful writers. No one was reading them. They were buried at the bottom of a cellar, and nobody ever talked about them. You know, you don't have a literature unless you can have a conversation about it. That's really what constitutes literature. It's a conversation about a literature. Read the books, and you talk about them with other people who read the books, and eventually it starts to get interesting. That's what makes it literary criticism. You can't do that about books that no one has read, including yourself. And you can't get the benefit of it. I mean, reading these people, there are some very stunning and difficult things in this book. Some early instances of absolutely horripilating racism. It's very tonic to read them. And to see that, you know, the racism that we saw in Bensonhurst in 1989 wasn't unprecedented. And in fact was in some ways the last gasp of something that had been going on for a century before. So much of what Italian Americans have done in culture amounts to a really sad and frenetic exercise in bella figura. I don't know if you all know what that is. I describe it this way. There are two rules that you learn growing up in an Italian house. One of them is called omerta, which means, as my grandmother would elegantly say, don't tell nobody nothing. And the other one is bella figura, which I translate, and if you must say something, lie.
This is the in Torquato Aceto, in the 17th century, called this dissimulazione onesta.
Yeah, that's right. Honest dissimulation. Sincere
dissimulation.
It's the best way to be a salesman. You really have to believe that the fact that the key falls out of the ignition is an advantage. And then you can sell the Chevy. Otherwise, it's very hard to do. We have spent, not we, us, but Italian Americans, I think, have spent an enormous amount of time trying to sustain completely ridiculous cases. Should I keep going? I should stop, probably, right?
I'll cue you.
Here's one. Here's my favorite of them all. In 1998 or 99, something like that, the Sopranos began to hit. And pretty soon after that, there was a group of attorneys in Chicago that called itself AIDA,
Italian Defense Association.
American Italian Defense Association, but they like calling themselves AIDA.
Right.
Why, I don't know, because they didn't wear drag. I mean, they were. They came to a luncheon, yes, that the NIAF had at the Hilton Hotel in New York, and that I was at. And I was seated at their table because I was one of the speakers at some conference they had that day. And the chief, one of these guys, was sitting next to me, and he was puffing out his chest. He told me about the blow that they had just struck for the Italian image. And they had filed a suit in a district court, I guess it was, in Chicago. There's a
state,
law.
State court.
State court. There was a state law, an anti-defamation law in Illinois, under the terms of which they were trying to get the state of Illinois to forbid the broadcast of this show in the state of Illinois, which would have changed everything, of course. And so he was talking about. Now, I happen to be one of those people who thought that
it
was brilliant.
But the law, the penalty
was a verbal sanction. That was it.
That we're going to get.
Yeah, they just it's a finger. It was a finger wag.
I'm sure David Chase was shaking in his boots. But you know, lots of people thought The Sopranos was a lot of it was lamentable, but it was really brilliant. And so, but I didn't say that to him. I said, "Tell me, have you ever actually seen this show?" And he said, "Well, we went down to the video store and we rented a few episodes. And we sat down to watch it, but we found it so boring that we didn't bother." So now let me get this straight. You're going to go into the highest court in the state of Illinois and ask them to abrogate the First Amendment in this instance about a show which is the most highly regarded television serial probably in recent memory, if not in all history, and you didn't even bother to look at it? Do you think that someone might ask you an embarrassing question? And so he had no reply to that. So he said, "Well, tell me what's so great about it." And I said, "Well, you know, for one thing, you know, we've all seen The Merchant of Venice, which is a very anti-Semitic play."
No.
It is and it isn't. Let me finish. It's a very anti-Semitic play in that all of the stereotypes, or many of the stereotypes about Jews, are summarized in the character of Shylock. But Shakespeare performs the great trick of showing you Shylock from the inside so that you understand him. And so then it's not an anti-Semitic play. I mean, it's really equivocal in a very brilliant and unsettling way. I said, that's what David Chase has done with this gangster. Yes, he's a gangster, but also, you know, he's an upwardly mobile guy in New Jersey. Overweight, he could be governor. I didn't say that. At that moment, it wasn't evident. But, well, this went on, and I will stop right there on that. But this is the kind of thing that constituted cultural conversation among Italian Americans of the professional class for decades. And the question of looking at a work of literature with open eyes and an open mind and seeing what about it was honest and what about it was perhaps not honest but worked and what didn't work and all those kinds of things that you learn to do when you study literature, that never could come up because there was always this kind of, you know, no, never say those things, it's shameful. This takes us way past that. This takes us into an area where we can start to really talk about an actual literary history that doesn't just go back to the WPA. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but this is on the plan.
First of all, let me tell you that I am so happy to have this book translated and so happy to be among all these wonderful people, these wonderful friends of mine, including Anthony Viscusi and all the people that have been nominated. Nominated is another word, excuse me. This is the time after 3 or 4 days, my English, which is not at a very high level, dramatically drops down and there's a moment in which I have to start speaking only Italian or possibly Neapolitan dialect, which is better for me. Anyway, I found it very interesting, the idea, Anthony, you told it before, the first generation Italian-American coming and telling stories, talking to their children, and highly wanting their children not to be Italian, but to become, as soon as possible, 100% Americans. Mm-hmm. But anyway, these children keep something in the memory, as John Fante does. All his writing is about his family, is about his father, his mother, and many writers of the second generation do this. Besides, I translated 7 books by John Fante, and I am the editor of the Italian edition in the Meridiani Mondadori of all the collected works by John Fante. And then comes John Fante and writes about his family, and he writes about his family with his so lively and free and new voice, mm-hmm. that is able to influence the young Italian writers. Mm-hmm. So you see, it's a trip back to Italy in a way. And so the new Italian writer of the after World War II, in the early 50s, the neorealismo in a way, for the first time, but 50 years later, 50 years after those of the first generation, tell story about humble people, you know, mm-hmm. about that, tell the truth about real life. And this kind of trip back to the old country is something that very often happens in modern Italian culture. For instance, I live in this old and incredible town called Naples, and something that we Neapolitans sometimes can't really stand is all the oleography, is all the stereotypes, is all the tradition, you know? Mm-hmm. Thinking about when I hear the word Pulcinella, I would like to take my gun and shot, you know? But then comes a guy, John Turturro, mm-hmm. with a film, Passione, about the most oleographic thing of all, the Neapolitan songs. And this is a new spectacle. It's something completely new, even for us. And first we were bored, and now we are proud. Because new eyes can show you the real color of reality, you know? Because you are used to things that you think are always the same, but they are not. And this is exactly what sometimes I felt when I was reading these writers of the second, but even of the first generation. And so this is why I'm so happy to have been, I'm so also proud to have been compared to Enea Silvio Piccolomini, Pope Pius II, going to a monastery in Switzerland. Yes, Ambrogio Traversari and all those great humanists of the 15th century. You know, in a way, it's true.
It's because, true. Because it's true.
Because this is the palimpsest of real Italian popular culture, in a way.
Absolutely. Can I reply to this?
Of course.
I, for the last 32 years, I have been the director and then executive officer of the Institute for the Humanities at Brooklyn College, which is the most wonderful job there is, because I don't actually have, first of all, I don't have to grade freshmen deans ever again. And let me tell you, if you never did that when you were young, four sets of papers twice a week, you have no idea what drudgery is. I mean, I've loaded trucks. This was much worse than loading trucks. I never wanted to commit suicide loading trucks, but I sometimes wanted to jump out the window when I had a very high stack of papers, and I thought, how will I? You know. But what the Humanities Institute does, it runs a kind of an endless Chautauqua tent of lectures about everything under the sun, everything that any kinds of professors are interested in. Our motto is Nihil Humani Alienum. Nothing human is foreign to us. So we don't just restrict ourselves to the classical humanities, but somebody once asked me to devise an introduction to the humanities. And so I spent about a year thinking, how could I have a course in the humanities that would really get to the heart of it, and it would only be 6 weeks long? Because usually in introductions to the humanities, they read a lot of long books. They read the Iliad, the Odyssey, the Aeneid, Gerusalemme Liberata, all this stuff. You can't do this in 6 weeks. So I thought about Petrarca, and because he really is the one who codifies what we call humanism. And what did Petrarca do? He did two things. I mean, he did more than two things, but two things that constitute the humanities. The first thing was go looking for manuscripts. Go looking for the traces
and literature that lies underneath everything that you're saying and doing. And the other thing that he did was he revived the study of classical rhetoric, which became really basically the spine of the curriculum. And it still is, even though they don't call it that anymore. And I wish that they would, because they would get less confused. But it's really quite simple. And once I did that, I began to have a better feeling about what my job was. Because it used to puzzle me all the time, like, what am I doing here? You know, they planted me in this job, and I took it because I liked it. It was a lot of fun. We invited famous people. I could have lunch with them. Sometimes they were fun. Often they weren't. And sometimes, forget about it. There's nothing to say. But, you know, what is the humanities? When people talked about it, I would get bored. Immediately they start talking about it, fall asleep. But this is something I can really understand. And think of how powerful it was, what they did in the 15th century. It just transformed education. It transformed the very notion of scholarship, culture, and particularly historiography. You know, in the Middle Ages, people used to write histories out of their heads. Or, you know, they would read the Gospel of John, and then they would, you know, eat a mushroom, take a nap, and then they would have a revelation, and that would be the history. Well, you know, after the 15th century, that started not to be able to happen anymore. People started looking at documents, you know, the way maybe Thucydides did. It certainly reads as if it was looking at documents. It's enormously consequential, enormously consequential. And that's where this puts us. This puts us on the level of what you might call a scientific humanities. This is an expression you can use in Italian. In English, it doesn't seem to make any sense, but in Italian, you can say that. This puts us in the world of a scientific humanities, where you really are looking at things that haven't been looked at for a long time. You're looking at them fresh. You're being shown them by someone who's looking at them fresh. And the way that Tuturro did with Canzone Napoletana for you, you did with this for us.
Thank you. Jim?
Yeah, just a couple of things. One is how things are changing. About 3 or 4 weeks ago, I had lunch with someone who I had met through Bob, a very distinguished Americanist who is Italian, and he's semi-retired. This is the man who in 1956 or 57 came to America on a Fulbright and was the first person to look at F. Scott Fitzgerald's papers at the Princeton University Library. And he's written elegantly about Fitzgerald, about Henry James, and about American literary theory. So I busily read as much of his work as I could before the lunch because I wanted to be prepared to admire this important work he'd done in American literature. And we started our lunch. The first 10 minutes was his apologizing to me. He had no cause to apologize to me at all. I was stunned by this. And he said, you know, I'm one of those Italian snobs who is now reformed. And he said, for decades, I've thought the Italians in America did nothing of any importance, he said. But Bob has gradually educated me, and I've read a lot of this material. And he said, I was so wrong. And this is a very distinguished scholar. And anyway, it was quite a way to start off a lunch. But I don't know if that conversation could have happened 20 or 10 or even 10 years ago or even 5 years ago. But it is a stunning kind of development, I think. And he probably really should have thanked Francesco if he knows him. And Francesco knows everybody, so I'm sure he knows who I'm talking about. The second thing I wanted to say is there would have been a time 5 or 10 years ago when we would have been speaking to you all, and there would be, and for most people in the audience, for nearly everyone, this all would have been new. But the flourishing of this scholarship and research, you know, obviously extends far beyond what we four up here have done. And I hope it's not amiss if I were to mention, hopefully not miss anybody, but mention some of the wonderful scholars who are sitting right here in this room who've done a lot of the legwork, the advance work, the groundwork. Number one to mention is Hermann Haller, who is sitting in the first or second row over there, who from back in 1993, tra Napoli e New York, l'italiano degli italoamericani, and tra Napoli, what's the other? Tra Napoli e New York, and...
Migliaccio.
Right, and then the work on Migliaccio. Marcello Bencivenni has done some marvelous work on radical Italians and has really helped flesh out. Her work was among others, important to me in doing my catalog, and I acknowledged her in my catalog for the great, vivid life of the Italian radicals that she portrayed. Of course, Simone Cinotto in the back there, who has just done marvelous things about Italian family life and food no one else has done. I also see my friend Alexandra DeLuise, whose work is very important to mine in that she's written about the reading habits and the library and lists of books of Italian Americans, you know, vitally important work that really only a library scholar would really know how to do and do well. And all of that is part, all of the work of these folks, and I'm probably leaving somebody out, forgive me if anybody wants to raise their hand, but this kind of work, I left two people out?
I'll tell.
Okay, Anthony can mention, so forgive me if I left you out. But in any event, this is all the groundwork, this is part of the groundwork, you know, that we've laid, really, what Francesco has, but I thank all of you scholars for the wonderful work you've done to enrich the whole field.
First of all, the people whom you don't know, and therefore there was no leaving anyone out if you don't know them, it's a sign without a signifier. Two of our counselors are here, Marilla Russo and Dominic Carrielli, who have done work in psychological counseling and organized a great conference, and Dominic co-edited the proceedings of that, and also Donna Chirico is actually someone who teaches at York, whom I discovered online, thanks to what we can find, and I found this Chirico woman at York who was writing on
esoteric and exoteric.
Wait a second. So we've also rediscovered some hardcore social science going on, and then of course there's our colleague Joseph Shore, who really has done some major work on religious studies, on music, and so on and so forth. But I want to say just a couple of things as they decide what they're going to do. Jim's catalog is, and I'm being a little bit self-referential here when you hear who published it, Jim's catalog is really important because it's a wonderful companion piece to this book, because it talks about, as a whole, the works that are anthologized here, and it's available actually in paperback. And this is the cover of it. It obviously doesn't say Grill Your Club on it. Francesco Durante has translated Fante. Fante is a god in Italy. As he said, the Meridiani series, it's nice rice paper with the leather. The classics are there, you know, from the classical Latin, Greek, classical Italians, and so on and so forth. And John Fante is there. This little Italian guy is there. Italian-American guy is there. Fante is, there are writers in Italian we can look to. One that comes to mind is Vasco Pratolini, who really did what, they don't call it this in Italian, but it's working class literature. They talk about working class literature. In Italian we'd say la letteratura del proletariato, del sottoproletariato, or something to that effect. There are other things going on. There are some other publications along the way that's happening in Italy with regard to Italian writers, and I want to, one is the journal Studi Italiani has decided that they would open up an area to, no, you can't open that, oh, I'm sorry, that they would open up an area dedicated to Italian writers in the United States, living writers. But Fordham engaged in yet another editorial challenge, and that is to put together an anthology entitled Poets of the Italian Diaspora. so that there are poets who write in Italian who have been translated into English from 14 different countries around the world, outside of Italy, obviously. And so this is a new conversation for Italy, and it's a new conversation for the United States. And as Bob said, this book would not be available without the financial support of a number of people, both financial support and also rolling up their sleeves and doing the type of PR work that really has not been done in Italian American studies to this degree. One is with us tonight, Anthony Viscusi. His wife walked in late, Margot Viscusi, who had the wonderful reception the other night to sort of kick off this week of events. Who's not here, the person who's not here, who's also very instrumental, is Laura Baudo-Sillerman, who made a grant in honor of her late friend, Anne Bancroft. So there are other people. There's a list of, I think, 84 or 85 individuals from modest to very exorbitant contributions. And that is also a first, that all of that was done for a literary product. And so we need to recognize that, and we need to hope that this experience here is the model for future works, right? And you're not the only people who are going to hear this, because this is going to go up on YouTube, and other people will be able to hear it as well. Great. Yes.
Can I ask something? Yep. There's just one other thing, another major event this year, which is that Anthony Tamburi and Fred Gardefee wrote a grant to the Rockefeller Foundation to support a conference at their Bellagio Center, which is a very nice place, as I'm sure you all know. There was a meeting of, I think there were 10 Italian-Americanists and 9 Americanists in Italy. Because what Anthony, with his keen critical eye, had noticed was that the Americanists in Italy never talked about Italian-Americans very much, or they talked about Italian-Americans much less than they seemed to suggest at the meetings. They were quick to rise to the challenge. But and out of these meetings, we formed an association, the Italian American
Network
Studies Network. We spent an entire morning arguing about that, what we would call it. At one point, we were going to call it the dungeon, but I'm just making that up. But we did have some funny ideas. This is totally unprecedented. The conversation that Jim was referring to with our friend, the famous English professor from northeastern Italy, great man, great writer, could not have happened 10 years ago or any time sooner than that. Lots of things couldn't have happened, but we've all been, you know, chipping away. But this was a moment. I mean, I've never really seen anything like this. Towards the end of the conference, maybe even at the end of the conference, we took a boat ride.
Yes.
They took us on a boat ride around the Lago di Como, which is apparently very deep. I didn't know that. None of us jumped in that way. And I saw something I have never seen before. There's a bunch of scholars at a conference taking pictures of each other. Hundreds of pictures. I mean, there was this huge explosion of them on
Facebook.
Yes, they've subsided now, but it was a great moment, and I think great things will come out of it, because, you know, they would always want, if you're an Americanist, I mean, I teach American literature sometimes, if you go to Italy, they want you to talk about Scott Fitzgerald, or worse, Hemingway. I mean, I like Hemingway, I'm not against Hemingway, but I got tired of Italians talking about Hemingway. It was like nothing had happened. As if Vittorini hadn't died, you know. Anyway, this is something that itself merits a very big hand, I think. Really, a big thing.
Okay, meanwhile, we decided to read 2 small pieces, Don't Be Afraid. The first one is coming from a small novel published in 1927 in Philadelphia, Il Presidente Scoppetta, ovvero La Società della Madonna della Pace, which is the adventures of a typical Italian-American prominent of the first generation, and a typical Italian-American association. Maybe you have?
No, it's not.
No, it's not. We thought it was. No.
Of course, Jim got the original.
I had the original.
And the small part we are reading is the speech that Ciccio Saverio Scoppetta is giving at the annual picnic of the Società della Madonna della Pace. And it is a speech made in a very broken Italian because he doesn't know Italian anyway. And he says, Sorgi, fratello, membra mascoli e membra femmine. Questi picchinicco è un picchinicco che non credo c'è stato mai un picchinicco come a questo picchinicco. E io vi assicuro che in questa giornata strabiliante questa festa è una festa che non credo c'è stata mai una festa come a questa festa che stiamo festeggiante in questi giorni di festa. Io vi assicuro che questa giornata di oggi rimane sempre scritta nelle mie viscere. Applausi. Prima di tutto mi dobbiate scusare se aggio venuto vestuto a così indecendo come a tutti quanti voi altro. Ma che volete? Io volevo mettermi la mia divisa stamattina, ma non aggio potuto trovare la sciabola militare e così aggio dovuto venire vestito come un imbecillo. Ma non fa niente però, io non mi posso mai scordare il grandioso banchetto che lei mi abbiate fatto poco tempo fa, perché io so benissimo che avrebbe andato tutto benissimo se quel fratello vigliacco non s'avesse arrobato il complimento che la società mi aveva complimentato. Ma in questa festa di oggi però speriamo che con l'aiuto di Dio non ci deve succedere nessuno trobolo. E vi raccomando, se qualcuno vi consulta, mantenetevi calmi e non vi menate subito con le mani. Anzi, facitemelo sapere a me che se lui vi ha dato un cazzotto a lei, io ce ne do un tre a lui. E lo faccio iettare lo sangue. Lei, sapete benissimo che il vostro presidente non vi ha mai abbandonato. Solo mi dispiace una cosa ed è questa, che lei non rispettate il vostro presidente come dobbiate e questa è una mancanza che assolutamente non può andare avanti così. Per esempio, chi vi ha dato il permesso stamattina di stardare prima di me? To start, prima di me. Allora, se non mi volete ubbidire e mi volete invece trattare come un ucetrulo, questo è un altro paro de maniche. Nella società della Madonna della Pace ci deve essere da sempre la voce, la pace e la concordia, sta bene, ma il presidente non è mica una mazza di scopa oppure un cetrulo e deve da essere rispettato. E perciò vi dico che se acchiappo a quello che ha stardato stamattina senza il permesso mio, lo faccio in turzanganno il picchinicco. It's a little bit long,
I can't follow that, but I have to. Rise, brothers, male members and female members. This picchinicco is a picchinicco that I don't believe there has ever been a picchinicco like this picchinicco. I assure you that on this amazing day, this feast is a feast that I believe there has never been a feast like this feast. That we are feasting in these days of festivity. I assure you that the day of today will always be in guts. First of all, you must forgive me if I came dressed in such an indecent manner like all of you. But what can I tell you? I wanted to put on my uniform this morning, but I could not find my military saber, and so I had to come dressed like an imbecile. But that's okay. I will never be able to forget the magnificent banquet that you gave me not long ago. More applause. Because I know very well that all would have gone very well had not that cowardly brother not stolen the compliments that the society had paid to me. Big silence. But on this feast of today, however, let's hope that with the help of God, there will be no trouble. And I beg you, if someone wants to insult you, keep calm and don't start fighting. In fact, let me know, because if someone gives you a punch, I'll give him three, and I'll make him spit blood. You know very well that your president has never abandoned you. For example, who gave you permission this morning to start dare before me? Now, if you do not want to obey me, and instead you want to treat me like a fool, that's another kettle of fish. In the society of the Lady of Peace, there must always be peace and harmony, and that's good. But your president is by no means a scrub or a fool, and he must be respected. Therefore, if I catch that person who started out this morning without my permission, I'll stuff the Pikiniko down his throat.
And this is a... This, the speech of the Pikiniko is a work by Pasquale Seneca, who was an instructor in Italian language at the University of Pennsylvania. He was coming from Benevento. Asked Anthony Viscusi, so I was proud. And now the second piece is is a completely different kind of piece. It's a political one. And is the typical prose of that giant that was Carlo Tresca. And it's a prose that I found incredible because it's so radical, so straight, so dangerous in a way. You know, in Italy at the time, after three lines of a prose like this, the carabinieri would come and arrest him immediately for libel, you know. Anyway, this was published on Il Martello, the newspaper that Tresca edited, and it's an article describing Tresca's greatest enemy, Gene Pope, the publisher of Il Progresso Italoamericano. First in Italian?
First in Italian, sure.
Okay. The title of this article is Il fascista Gene Pope è un uomo di paglia. Credevo che generoso Pope, proprietario del Progresso e del Corriere di New York e dell'Opinione di Filadelfia, fosse un uomo di fegato. Mi accorgo che è invece un uomo di paglia. Gli ho spifferato sul viso come una scudisciata che lascia i segni della sua forza un'accusa precisa, dettagliata, quella di essere un racketeer e un gangster. Mi sembrò sulle prime che egli volesse ripagarci di misura continuando a fare il gangster. Infatti, appena pubblicata la mia accusa, un certo signore, uno dei due di cui si serve Pope per intimidire gli avversari, il suo nome è noto a Pope e ai miei amici, è venuto a farmi visita agli uffici del Martello, 94 Fifth Avenue. Verissimo, una visita di cortesia, era tutto cerimonie e chiese con squisita garbatezza una copia del Martello nella quale era pubblicata la mia requisitoria contro Pope. Il significato di visite del genere conosciamo io e Pope e quanti si intendono dei metodi che usano i gangsters. Può essere considerata una bravata, una innocua manifestazione di coraggio. Farò vedere io a costoro che noi abbiamo finanche il coraggio di andarli a scovare in casa. Io non disputo il coraggio di tal gente, solo dico di averne altrettanto e di non temerli. Può essere considerata come un ammonimento, ma io dico che siamo in guerra e in guerra guerreggiata e tra forze in aperta contesa non c'è bisogno di preavvisi. E volevo dare a generoso Pope, anche in inglese, affinché mi sentissero i numerosi amici americani che ho interessati alla disputa per ragioni preventive ed affinché si possano accertare le future eventuali responsabilità, su per giù questi consigli. Tieni a bada i tuoi. Questa non è una partita che si definisce come quelle che hai chiuso con Giordano e Sisca e Bernabei. Se casco io, tu mi segui inevitabilmente. Ma mi accorgo che ho di fronte un uomo di paglia. Forse. It's enough. This is makes me shivering because, you know, it's just like Tresca knew what his end was going to be, prima o dopo, insomma. Anyway.
The fascist Gene Pope is a man of straw. Generoso Pope, proprietor of the Progresso and the Corriere of New York and the Opinione of Philadelphia, I believed was a man with guts. Now I learned that instead he is a man of straw. I have openly put before him, like a lashing that makes his mark, its mark, a precise, detailed accusation, that of being a racketeer and a gangster. In fact, no sooner was my accusation published than a certain gentleman, one of two that Pope uses to intimidate his opponents, his name is known to Pope and to my friends, came to pay a visit at the offices of the Martello, 94 Fifth Avenue. Really, a courtesy call. He was all politeness, and he requested, with exquisite good manners, a copy of the Martello in which my prosecutorial summary against Pope had been published. Pope and I both know the meaning of such visits, and how much they resemble the methods gangsters use. It can be considered an act of bravado, harmless show of courage. I will make it clear to them that we have the courage to flush them out, even at home. I do not doubt the courage of such people. I only say that I too have courage and that I do not fear them. They can take this as a warning. But I say that we are in open battle, and between forces in open battle, there is no need for warning. And I wish to give Generoso Pope this advice, even in English, so that the many American friends I have who are interested in this dispute for preventive reasons might understand me, and so they might be able to learn who would be more or less responsible for what might take place. Keep your men at bay. This is not a game that can be defined like those who have played with Giordano in Sisca and Bernabei. If I fall, you inevitably follow me. But now I see that I have before me a straw man. And then he goes on to make the case that Pope, after threatening him, says, well, you know, let's be friends, and, you know, Tresca says, I don't want to be friends with you. You're a murderer.
He was murdered, and who knows? At a certain point he says, gli antifascisti non ti daranno mai pace finché tu continuerai a fare con i tuoi giornali la propaganda a favore del fascismo. And then he says, e ci fai schifo. It's a lot of incredibly hard attacks to Pope and so on.
Thank you. What we'll do now is we'll have questions if you have any questions, but let me ask you to, Rosangela will pass around the microphone so that we can get you on tape. Thank you.
How many years did this book take?
The English version?
Yes.
When did we start? 2007, maybe?
About
6 or 7 years. It seemed like we were going to die before we finished. And there were plenty of times when I thought, well, that wouldn't be so bad. It was hard because, you know, it's a long story how it happened, but we originally had thought that really all we need to do was raise the money on a kind of a book package and do all of that, but that didn't work out. So then we had to do it ourselves. And that was, I had never done such a thing before. And it was a very steep learning curve. And if it weren't for Anthony
sitting at the other side of the table reassuring me that what I was saying wasn't crazy. I don't know if I could have lived through it.
There were also some external challenges. I mean, there were personnel changes along the way in various institutions and so on and so forth. So, yeah.
Well, and there were, although the translators were very good, there were one or two that weren't so good. That is to say, they just disappeared.
This is true.
They just, you know, they didn't take the money, but, well, maybe they did. We don't know. We don't know. It's a mystery.
But we will recognize Julia Preste because she filled in
she certainly did.
Yeah.
There are at least two people here who were lifesavers. Julia, when one or two people either dropped out, there was one person who just seemed to get tired, and he started handing in things that had big chunks of Italian in them, and I didn't really know what his idea of a translation consisted of, but I didn't want to have the conversation that would follow that. So I called Julia, whom I've known a long time, and she was great, and she was accurate, quick, professional. And the other one, the real sort of fireman of the thing, was Richard Montiaccio, who's an attorney with a great command of Neapolitan. And a lot of the dialect in this book is Neapolitan, or sort of Neapolitan anyway. And
we got even Calabrian dialect, Sicilian dialect, Roman dialect, actually. Right. Neapolitan of all sorts.
And a little bit of Tuscan, even, right?
Yeah.
But anyway, Richard was great at translating things, and very rapid, very rapid. If all of the translators had been as quick as him, we would have been finished
years
when
ago.
When we started in 2007, we would have been finished in 1995.
Well, first of all, of course, I want to commend you for doing this. This is long overdue, and I think it's so important, not just because it opens, you know, a whole literary world that was not known before, but to me, it also says so much about that immigrant experience. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one thing that we don't realize is that we might not recognize most of these names, but they were incredibly popular mm-hmm. to the Italian immigrants of that time. You know, people like Tresca, I mean, you know, they had a huge following. And, you know, people read these newspapers. People read and bought newspapers just to know what happened to the next installment mm-hmm. of the novels. So, you know, many of these novels, like the one with Ciambelli, were published, you know, as serious, yeah. You know. So, unfortunately, you know, the question of reception will probably never be answered. Like, you know, what did the Italian, you know, immigrants who read, who consumed this literature, thought about it? Unfortunately, that's, you know, we can just speculate about it. But we do know, I mean, you know, that these were, in fact, very popular, you know, writers at the time. And I really liked, Bob, what you said about, you know, and so the other question that I think it's really key to Italian-American studies as a whole is then, you know, so why have been these things lost for so long? So there is this, you know, I think constant theme within, you know, Italian-American studies about, you know, things that are lost and then they come back. And why are they lost, you know, why, you know, so there is this issue about memory. I mean, I think that, again, this opens up so many opportunities for deeper questions that really transcend just the literary world. And so I'm really hoping that you're trying to target this, not just for, you know, literary scholars, whether they are Italian or, you know, Americanist. I mean, this is an opportunity for historians, for sociologists, for political scientists, for, you know, labor, historians to engage with material and sources that were not available before.
Yeah,
so
I think,
thank you.
It's an outrageously complex issue, but Bob and Daniela Giuseppe have a common reference point, and that is the onslaught of the law of the enemy alien. When 4 days after Pearl Harbor, the United States declared war on the Axis and vice versa and so on and so forth. And so there's that sense of speak American, do not speak the enemy's language. And we all know those posters, right, with the three caricatures, et cetera. I think that's part of it. I think that underscored a great deal of shame that may have existed, whatever. And the loss of language was really something significant in cutting off any sort of cultural transmission from those before 1941.
We have, most of us, lived in the United States for the last 60 or 70 years in a kind of a very protected shell. I mean, 10 years ago, we conducted a war in which we just basically destroyed the cradle of civilization without even noticing. It was all done on a credit card. You know, they borrowed the money. When people died, they came back to the country. The bodies weren't allowed to be photographed coming in. So people, you know, just didn't really think about it. But if you think about this, this is a direct consequence of political disaster. Mussolini and the people who were allied with him are responsible for this. Mussolini seduced the Italian Americans, and then he abandoned them. He seduced them systematically for 20 years, and then he just signed it away in a minute. And they were up the creek. His grandmother had to register as an enemy alien. He has the card in his office. He'll show it to you. A couple of thousand people ended up in concentration camps, although not too many and not for too long. But plenty of others died. You know, there were all of those Scottish Italians who were shipped off to Canada, thanks to Winston Churchill in 1940. And on the 2nd of July, off the northern coast of Scotland, a U-boat sank the ship, the Arendora Star, and I don't know, 500 Italians drowned, as well as a lot of other people, too. There were Jews in that ship, and there were gypsies, and, you know, the usual lot, but lots and lots and lots of Italians. Men, fathers of families, who were being shipped to some concentration camp or whatever farm in Canada. We lost all of this because of that. I was born in 1941. My grandparents would not, their English was terrible. But they would not speak Italian to me except to say, shut up and eat. That was it. Because they did not want me to speak Italian, because they were shivering at the thought of it. Not just that they thought we wouldn't get into Yale. They didn't know what Yale was, except a lock, you know. But they were afraid for us. And they had every reason to be. Now, in this sense, I think it's very parallel to the loss of the classical manuscripts. You know, they were buried because the Catholic Church had fallen into the hands of fanatical iconoclasts who would burn anything that referred to the pagan gods. And, you know, Augustine in the City of God mounts the most energetic and totally lame defense of this that I have ever read. I mean, I read that book when I was living in Rome and actually threw it across the room, something I have never done in my life with another book. It's just so infuriating that he would, like the worst kind of priest, defend what was clearly indefensible. That's the reason. It's not something that, this isn't a question of the loss of memory. This is the question of the destruction of people's ability to be who they were. They were afraid. And we were then absolutely incapacitated. The greatest moment of my life was when I got an NEH grant that let me take my family to go and live in Italy, and I could actually learn Italian. I lived in Italy for a year and I learned to speak Italian. I wrote an essay about it once saying, it's impossible to imagine what it's like to start to speak for the first time in your life a language in which your own name is a word. Because growing up in American schools, everybody mangled my name. And of course, you know, when you're the foreigner and a little kid, you can't correct the big nun who'll hit you if you do, you know. I don't mean to be so strong-minded. I'm sure there's plenty else to say, and the implications, psychological, social, are infinite. But it's really, this is fascism that did this to us. Really. Fascism in its very largest sense. That's my view, anyway.
I would just like to follow up on something that Francesco said earlier about the impact, or the potential impact of the Italian book on Italian consciousness with respect to the roots in immigration and Italian amnesia with respect to their own history of immigration. And what I'd like to ask is that you address the potential impact of this book on Italian Americans who, some of us might say, also suffer from the same amnesia when they relate to more recent immigrants to the United States.
You should answer better than I can to a question like this, because I don't live in America, and so I got the feeling that this problem is a real problem anyway. Being a fan of Spike Lee's movie, I knew that there are problems, of course. So yes, living together is something very difficult, I think. But anytime I come to New York, I breathe. It seems to me that I can breathe a fresh air because, you know, it's a spectacle of the world, and that's very nice, very human, you know. But I don't really know. I don't expect to be so educated so important for two countries.
Anyway. No, but you know, let me. There are pieces here that were written in 1904, 1905, 1909 that speak to these issues.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. And once in English, original English, Gino Speranza, who is an interesting case because then he becomes, he does 180 degree flip later on in the early 20s. But there are a couple of Italian ex-diplomats who write about that and write about how the Italians are being how the immigrants are being mistreated. Yeah. And so that reading becomes very important. And I think the fact that it's at the beginning of the book, anyone who gets this as a Christmas or any other holiday present will at least make it through the first 50 pages if they don't get tired of holding the book, and they'll get to those essays.
That's right, and there will be conversations. I want to say something about something that you started by saying, Marcello, about the difficulty of interpreting this stuff. Remember this. Literary history is as patient as the popes. It takes forever. I mean, people are still writing commentaries on Virgil and Petrarca centuries and centuries later. This is the first opening of the tomb. Think of the number of diaries in Italian that these people must have kept. My own grandfather didn't keep a diary. But he read the Progresso Italo-Americano every day of his life. He read La Follia every week until the last couple of years of his life when he got into an argument with the Siscas about his subscription. And he said, okay, he wouldn't take it anymore. But he read it for like 60 years or something like that. He didn't keep a journal, but I would be very surprised if nobody else kept a journal. But we haven't found it yet because no one has even looked for it yet. Or people who look through the papers, when they see stuff like this, they don't even know what to make of it. But people will talk about this book. People will talk about this book around the Christmas table or whatever, you know. We're in there. You know, we're in there. You find yourself in there. The article that Anthony just referred to by Gino Speranza is called "What Does It Feel Like to Be a Problem?" Which a title he lifted from W.E.B. Du Bois a couple of years earlier, and it's a terrific essay. And it's still germane. Plenty of people can relate to it. Plenty of Italian Americans can relate to it. So, you know, just goes back, I don't want to go on and on, but this goes, I already did.
This goes back to something I said earlier about literary history, to me, is a conversation. And the conversation inspires curiosity. And curiosity inspires the real research, where you go upstairs and you look in the top drawer of your aunt's dresser and you see what's in there. You know, maybe they're not all letters about her lover. Maybe some of them are about the books that she read. I had an aunt who belonged to the Book of the Month Club. And she would, I was a voracious reader even as a child, and she would always give me the books after she read them. And I read, I don't know, I was 7 or 8 years old. She gave me George Panetta's novel, We Ride a White Donkey.
Well, We Ride a White Donkey.
That was the first Italian-American book I ever read, and I never forgot it, you know. So it had a long, really a long-term impact on me, because I discovered that, hey, we were not invisible. You know, I used to read the comics in the Sunday paper. I never saw anybody who looked like anybody in my neighborhood. You know?
By mentioning Panetta and mentioning in the context of this book comes, there's another issue we've mentioned it sort of, and that is that Italian culture in the United States is bilingual, was, and is, continues to be bilingual, and you know there's, I mentioned Jim's bibliography catalog, which has, which is a nice little history of the whole works from which this anthology comes. And then, but there's also Rose Basile Green's bibliography at the end of her, the Italian-American novel, right? Over 200 and some odd books written in English by Italian-Americans that are published by major houses. Panetta's book was published by a major house at the time. And then to the autobiography, I'll toot a former student's horn, there's Ilaria Serra's book, The Worthless Lives. I had the title. It's Fordham University Press published it in 2007. Yeah, I can't remember right now. The Value of Worthless Lives.
Wonderful
Italian American autobiographies in which she discusses 59 autobiographies, many of which were unpublished, that she found in attics, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah.
Yes, Mary Capello had a grandfather. And she, her novel, what is it called?
Night Bloom.
Night Bloom is all about that. And her reading of it's really tremendously interesting, especially from the point of view of an historian. Because, you know, this is the place where literary history and history are really the same thing. And you can't even start without that. And all of the things that are going to follow it, because there'll be plenty.
I was talking about what Marcella told is, in some way, it was clear, even at the time, you know, there was a link between literature, narrative, and politics, and unions. For instance, Carlo Tresca, in his autobiography, and Carlo Tresca, we are speaking about an anarcho-syndicalist, is praising the first novel by Bernardino Ciambelli, I Misteri di Mulberry Street, and Ciambelli died a fascist in 1931. He was made Cavaliere by Mussolini. Because in I Misteri di Mulberry Street, there was a first, how do you call it, denuncia?
Renunciation.
Denunciation of the padrone system. And in a very nice, in a very strong manner. And so Tresca says that Ciambelli has educated me in a way to understand what was the real condition of laborers of Italian descent in this country, you know?
We have time for one more question, or?
No,
okay.
In front row. We can take two more. Yes.
Well, I'd like to ask a fundamental question. I've heard the name Gianfante tonight, and maybe I should be ashamed to say that until probably 3 years ago, I had never heard the name of Gianfante. And I consider myself a rather well-educated person. Until I met his son at a party in Tribeca. So, and when I was young, I would read novels. I no longer do. And I would read the classics, of course, you know, and there were books that were below our dignity as Columbia College students. We would not read them. However, at one point, I was persuaded to read ordinary books. They were bestsellers. So I asked the question, why is it that I read Malamud and I did not read John Fante?
The books were out of print.
The books were out of print for a long time.
It was why are they out of print? Now, I'd like to continue.
That's a seminar.
I read literary journals. I encounter the name of Malamud very, very often. I have never, never encountered the name of John Fante. Why? I think this is the important question to answer.
Well, there are a number of reasons why. First, besides the fact that they were out of print, they came back into print in 1980 and 81 by Black Sparrow Press, which is a small press out of Santa Rosa. Now I think it's one of the imprints of Frost, maybe Frost, Josh and Giroux, or some other big press. I don't know. But the other reason is clear and simple, because there is an American hegemonic canon, and they don't let people like Fante in. Our community, whether it's those of us who are in the twilight of our career, as well as the people who preceded us, are responsible for that. The community is responsible for it. And that's why when I said that this is an act of philanthropy second to none, it is an act of philanthropy second to none. And, you know, Fred Gardefe and I always joke, about when our anthology came out in 1991, and we would joke about the way people would ask how to come into possession of our book. They would say, you know, they wouldn't say, where can I buy your book? They say, how do I get a copy of that book? Well, it's simple. You go buy it. And so it's that, you know, and in a couple of the rants that I've made in print, you know, one of them was, how come in a major metropolitan area like New York, the Italian-American manager of a bookstore can't find 36 inches, that's one shelf, to have a section called Italian-American literature, right? When there's, you know, there's scratch-your-head literature, there's this literature, there's that literature, but for some reason it's not. Or when the director of a publishing house publishes a book by an Italian American about Italian Americans, but it ends up on the second or third page of the website, so you have to scroll through 15 or 20 titles before you come to it. Those seemingly insignificant acts are extremely significant, and that's a major, major part. They're wonderful writers. The one thing that we found when we put From the Margins together, and it was basically from 87 to 89, is that there's just a plethora of Italian-American writers who write some really good stuff. We thought we were going to have a 250-page manuscript. We ended up with 1,000 pages.
Anthony, may I say, you have not answered my question. You have repeated.
I've complicated it more.
Let me try. Okay. You want to know why you see the name of Malamud and you don't see the name of John Fante? That's a good question.
No, well, that's towards you.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, I didn't realize that it was on even. Anthony put it very politely. There's a hegemony. Let me make that a little bit more precise. A friend of mine works for John Wiley, the publisher. John Wiley, 8 years ago, bought, maybe even longer, bought Scribner Reference Books, which was the whole division of Scribner's. And they assigned this executive friend of mine the task of assessing the value of what they had bought.
And one of the things that he discovered was that in 1965, 66, something like that, that the Scribner Reference Book had published the Encyclopedia Judaica. You all know what that is. It's a magnificent work of scholarship. It's practically the size of a Britannica or the OED. And he found, looking at the records, that one person, one single don't, had purchased 6,000 sets and sent one to every single Jewish institution of learning or study or worship in the United States. Now, this is the reason that Jewish American literature gets the kind of attention that it does. It's because the people most interested in it invest in it. They buy the books, they teach the books, they read the books, they give the books to their children. They're interested in books. They believe in books. The whole religion is built around a book. And Italian Americans, for all kinds of reasons, probably mostly because so much of the migration was composed of analfabeti, you know, I don't really know this part of it, but I think that has a lot to do with it, really don't have so much of this tradition. We're getting there. It took us a long time to figure this out. I mean, I read Fante in 1980 when they first started publishing them. Charles Bukowski had discovered Fante. Yeah. And he persuaded Black Sparrow to publish it. I read the book. I wrote an article about it subito. I wrote a book about Italian-American literature. He has a whole chapter in that book. So it's not like we've been sitting on our hands, but there's only a few of us here, you know? And there was a big conference on Fante in California, what was it, about 10 years ago?
Yeah.
At UCLA.
It's not a household name by Malamud
Hicks. Look, I understand. I'm not contesting that. I'm trying to answer your question, though. That to make it a household name, it has to be in people's households. And, I mean, it's just that simple. It's not, we do the best we can, believe me. We stay up nights thinking of what to do next. And we've done a lot, few as we are. But it's very, very difficult sometimes. Because we don't have, as yet, it's coming up. I mean, I think in the newer generations we see a little more of it. But we don't have a public that wants the stuff. I mean, I once said in a fit of frustration, Italian Americans must really hate the truth because they don't want to read our books. You know, when you read really serious fiction, it tells you the truth, and it tells you the truth maybe in a way you really don't like. Now, some people have an appetite for what they don't like, and some people just have not. But I don't know if that's really what it is. That's just my piece.
The other issue is that we're not part of the college curriculum, and
working on that.
And we are working on that, but we're not part of the college curriculum. It's not clear where we belong, where Italian American studies belongs. Does it belong in Italian or does it belong in American studies? Some of us feel it can easily live in both worlds. Mm-hmm. But the Italian literary establishment in the United States, in general, is not hospitable to Italian-American literature. And we at Queens have put together four courses, a bouquet of courses on Italian-American literature and film. It's the first time in the United States that there are formalized courses on Italian-American literature and film. I taught a bunch of them for the PhD program at Purdue University, but they were special topics courses. And I taught a number of them at Florida Atlantic, but they were special topics courses. We need to get them into the curriculum, and it means that we need to convince the people who are running those programs that this is a worthy enterprise. Mm-hmm. And once that happens, then we have a much more broad generation of students who can go out and study.
However, Malamud is not in the Jewish American studies is part of American literature, why can't John Fante be part of American literature?
Well,
why should he be advertised?
That's fine, but because people don't know about him. With Fante in particular, I would submit to you that it's because there was such a big gap. And when he did come back, he came back with a boutique press, Black Sparrow Press.
And also, he is better known in the West. He's known as a Los Angeles.
Thank you. He's known as a Los Angeles writer. I actually have one quick story on this. About 10 years ago, Janet Maslin in the New York Times did virtually a full page review of, I think it was Stephen Cooper who put together a new collection.
Biography.
Well, no, it wasn't the biography. I think it was even a collection of his stories. The John Fante Reader. And Janet wrote this wonderful piece, although she said his name was pronounced Fante, and we all laughed about that, if you remember at the time. Anyway, I happened to see her on a regular basis. I was living in Westchester, and she's active in the Jacob Burns Film Center there. And I approached her, it was about a week after the article, and I said, Janet, that was a wonderful article you did about John Fante, but tell me, why did you think he wasn't known? Or she said something about how this is new, nobody knows about, nobody's ever heard of this guy. And she looked at me and she said, well, I'm going to pronounce the name wrong, Michiko, never heard of him before. Yeah, it's Michiko Kakutani, who's the chief reporter for the Times. And it was sort of, you know, illustrative of the point you're making, but even with that collection of stories and even with a full-page article in the Times, it didn't move him much on the needle, unfortunately. I don't know why. I don't know what the answer is, because if the Times and Janet Maslin recognizes Fante, you would expect that people would start reading him, but it didn't happen.
Just like as the American literary establishment has a very short memory. For instance, John Fante, during his life, was reviewed by people like Edmund Wilson, Carrie McWilliams. He was a friend with Bill Saroy and William Faulkner. He was the enfant gâté of Mencken. So he was recognized as an American writer, a real talent.
A great one, yeah.
By writers, but not by the public.
And even about the public, his first two novels did really well.
Right.
You know, we, especially Fred Gardefee and myself, went to the Met about this 21 years ago with Gay Talese. He was writing an article that appeared on the front page of the New York Times Book Review called Where Are the Italian American Writers? Now, I had
novelists,
I had heard him give this as a talk of sorts, I think at the Istituto Italiano di Cultura. And I said to him, you know, Mr. Talese, there's a lot of things that you really ought to know before you commit this to print. So we had long conversations, many long conversations in person and also on the telephone. And I told him all about John Fante, and I told him all about a lot of other writers. And his essay is still spoken of, you know, by people who are looking at the ground and perhaps spitting on it, too. I mean, because we are so depressed about it, because this was the one Italian-American writer who was really inside the establishment, who command the front page of the New York Times Book Review, and he wrote an essay that could have been written by a foreigner. He didn't, and Fred told him all the same things that I did and a lot of other things too. He's a very persuasive man. Didn't make any difference. And in fact, he I don't want to say what he said about Fred in the article, because it wasn't very nice. And not true either. I don't know why he was so obstinate about this. And if you ask him today, he'll repeat everything that he said in that article 21 years ago. He hasn't changed his mind at all. In the interim, let me remind you, in 1997 or so, Don DeLillo published
DeLillo won
Underworld, which won
the National Book Award.
And a couple of years later was listed by the New York Times as one of the 100 greatest American novels of the 20th century. Right. But when
Taleza talks about this, he doesn't mention that. And
but you know,
no, I'm not kidding. I wish I were.
There is something that to me is really clear about that article by Gay Taleza under an historical point of view. The only meaning of that article was marketing. For
Bravo.
Promoting his book and
Bravo.
Two songs.
Yes,
right.
Exactly.
He needed some rumor about that. That's the only reason why you.
The timing is very very curious.
But his whole standard for including people was that there were people who had major contracts, who had appeared in major magazines, were published by major publishers, and made major money. But even by that standard, DeLillo should be there. So, you know, I really don't quite get it. But no doubt, Francesco, who understands business.
By the way, this may add to something to the conversation.
I once was talking to a friend of mine who knew a lot about literature, translations, and so on. And we were talking about the fact that I was talking about the fact that, indeed, I did not know that many Italian-American novelists. And he gave me, and I've forgotten the names, he gave me a long list mm-hmm. of Italian-American novelists with Anglo-Saxon names.
Yes,
there are.
Yes, and many of them had great success with Anglo-Saxon names. Yes. You know, but the other thing is, the other thing is we have a couple of bestsellers today, but people don't read them. We're stuck in this sort of high culture, low culture bit, right? We have two women who are New York Times bestseller writers, Lisa Scottoline or Scottoline and Adriana Trigiani. And they write good stuff. One might be a little bit more popular, if you want to use that measuring stick, than the other. But they write interesting stuff. Adriana Trigiani writes about Italians in West Virginia, right there. Just that alone is important. You add the female perspective. That then adds another novel aspect to it. And then look at all the novels that Lisa Scottoline writes up until the last couple, because now she's become less Italian. But, you know, she's got this character, there's this female character, Mary D'Annunzio, she's a lawyer but becomes an investigator, and so on and so forth. And there's some, in 2004 she published Killer Smile, which has as the backdrop the whole enemy alien experience that many people didn't know about. You know, and for that alone, it becomes a very important novel. But it's also a good read. It's a good read. But we don't. We have to be the first community. We have to support them first. Because if we don't read them, then we can't expect others to read them. It really is that simple. So we can't ask, how do I get a copy of your book? The question is, where can I buy your book? That's the question. You know, Fred and I say, I'll say it, culture doesn't fall off a truck. Got to pay for it, you know? And we find that, and Bob's had this experience more than I have, because he's lived here longer in New York than I have, but it's really incredible how everything comes down to one phenomenon, and that is how much money you have in your bank account. That's the success for Italian-Americans. And the idea that that college education has another aspect, that is the sense of personal amelioration, you know, as they say in Italian, it doesn't enter the antechambers of their mind. That's our struggle.
You had a question?
You had a question, yes.
There has been, over the years, I've always noticed a great deal of prejudice against how we look. Now, I'm looking at all of you, and you all look entirely different, and yet you're all Italian-Americans.
What do you mean, how we look? How do we look?
Well, no, there's in America, there has been a prejudice against the typical Italian-looking...
Mustache Pete.
I've noticed it.
Well,
I've noticed it.
I think that there are certain types.
Well, if
certain stereotype looks.
Exactly.
We're all too experienced to look like that. We have a distinction.
Right, but Italy was occupied by many different countries. The Greeks occupied us 500 years before Christ. I mean, it's been, and then the French, the Germans occupied us. We all look entirely different. Yet, in this country, the typical looking Italian is very prejudiced.
There's a stereotype. No, you're right. There is a stereotype. You see it in the early cartoons, the drawings at the beginning, the end of the 19th century, and the beginning of the 20th century. You have that infamous cartoon of the human heads and rat bodies and so on and so forth that I've shown sort of ad nauseum. And so there is the mustache Pete. They all have these long handlebar mustaches, you know, and so on and so forth. Actually, the first Italian introduced to us in the cinema, and we'll end on this one because we've been here a long time. We have to sell some books, too. Culture doesn't fall off a truck. The introduction of the first Italian in cinema was called Dago Pete. Mm-hmm. Yeah, 1905, Skyscrapers of New York.
Well, I think with that, join me in thanking our speakers this evening.
The Civil War. My refrigerator is covered with one refrigerator.
Yeah.